Today's lesson is Indian Constitution. A constitution is a set of rules and regulations guiding the administration of a country. The Constitution of India is a framework for political principles, procedures, and powers of the government. It is a vehicle of a nation's progress. The concept of constitution was first originated in USA, that is United States of America. So, what is the definition for a constitution? A constitution is a set of rules and regulations guiding the administration of a country. So, it has a framework for political principles, procedures, powers of the government. So, what are the powers and functions of the prime minister? What are the powers and functions of the president? Likewise, so it is a most important vehicle for a nation's progress also. And this concept of constitution was first originated in United States of America. Next one. So we are seeing about the introduction. The next one is, what's the need for a constitution? So all the democratic countries have a constitution to govern them. A constitution tells us the fundamental nature of a society, how is our society, how the people are living like that. So it will be helpful in fulfilling the beliefs of different segments of citizens. So we are having different types of people are living in our country, different types of religion they are speaking, different types of caste people were living here. So to fulfill all the needs, we need a constitution. So what is mean by constitution? A constitution is a set of rules and regulations guiding the administration of a country. And what is the need? It will be helpful in fulfilling the beliefs of different segments of citizens. Okay, so we have learned about definition. Next one, what is the need? How the Indian constitution was made? So the next one is the making of Indian constitution. The Constitution of India was framed a constituent assembly set up under the Cabinet Mission Plan in 1946. In this constituent assembly consisted of 389 members only, and the assembly held its first meeting on December 9, 1946. So at that time, the temporary president of the constituent assembly is Dr. Sachidananda Sinha. While the work was in progress, he was died. Dr. Sinha was died, and Dr. Rajendra Prasad was elected as the president of the assembly. And who were the vice presidents of the assembly? H.C. Mukherjee and V.T. Krishnamachari were elected as the vice presidents of the assembly. Here, the assembly met for 11 sessions, and how many days it was conducted is along with 166 days of meeting. And there was a committee was framed for drafting the constitution. So the draft of the constitution was prepared by the drafting committee under the leadership of or chairmanship of Dr. Bhima Rao Ambedkar, or we can tell it as Dr. B.R. Ambedkar. And Dr. B.R. Ambedkar is recognized as the father of the Constitution of India, or father of the Indian Constitution. So, here these are the how they want to frame it. Finally, the constitution was adopted on November 26, 1949. So the constitution contained a preamble, 22 parts, 395 articles and 8 schedules. So fully all these drafted constitution came into force on 26 January 1950, and this day only we are celebrating as Republic Day every year. So which day we are celebrating as a Republic Day? 26 January. And on that day only, you have the drafted constitution came into force. So, how the constitution was made? So, the constitution of India was framed by a constituent assembly. And in that assembly, how many members are there? 389 members are there. And when it has its first meeting on December 9, 1946. And first temporary president is Dr. Sachidananda Sinha, and then Dr. Rajendra Prasad became the president of the Constituent Assembly. And who were the vice presidents of the assembly? H.C. Mukherjee and V.T. Krishnamachari. How many sessions it was conducted, the Constituent Assembly? For 11 sessions. For how many days? 166 days. And who is the chairman of the drafting committee? Dr. B.R. Ambedkar. Who is recognized as the father of Constitution of India? Dr. B.R. Ambedkar. And finally, when the Constitution was adopted? November 26, 1949. And what are the contained in the Constitution? A preamble, 22 parts, 395 articles, and 8 schedules. Finally, when the drafted Constitution came into force on 26 January 1950, and this day only we are celebrating as a Republic Day every year. So, what is mean by Constitution? A Constitution is a set of rules and regulations to administer the country. And what is the need to fulfilling the all the different segments of the categories of people? And final one, what how it was made? Next one is the salient features of Indian Constitution. That is, what are the important features contained in the Constitution? It is the very lengthiest of all the written constitutions of the world. So we are having a very lengthiest as well as a written constitution. It is partly rigid and partly flexible. The meaning for rigid and flexible is neither easy nor difficult. Some of the amendments we can make it easily. Some of the amendments we are having some different categories, procedures to amend that act. So that is why it is called as partly rigid and partly flexible. And it establishes the parliamentary system not only in the center but also in all the states. And India as a secular state. The meaning for secular is in our country anyone can follow any religion. It provides an independent judicial system and it introduces universal adult franchise, which means the right to vote to all the citizens above 18 years of age without any discrimination. And it provides only one citizenship, that is single citizenship. And it makes special provisions for minority people, that is scheduled castes, scheduled tribes, etc. So these are the salient features of the Indian Constitution. So once again, we can recall it. What are the salient features? One is lengthiest and written constitution. It is partly rigid and partly flexible. Parliamentary system, not only in the center, also in the states also. India as a secular state, independent judiciary, universal adult franchise, single citizenship, special provisions for minority people such as scheduled castes, scheduled tribes, etc. So definition we have saw. Next one is the need. Next one is the making. And what are the importance of the Constitution? So in the Constitution we have the preamble. So what's the meaning for your preamble? Preamble refers to the introduction or preface to the Constitution. So preamble means introduction. So only it is called as the key to the Constitution. So it has great value and has been described as the key to the Constitution. So which is called as a key to the Constitution? Preamble, that is introduction. The preamble to the Indian Constitution drafted by Jawaharlal Nehru, which was adopted by the Constituent Assembly on January 22, 1947. And the preamble contains states that India is a sovereign, socialist, secular, democratic republic, which means to secure to all Indian citizens socially, economical, and political justice to the all the citizens of India. So the preamble of our constitution states what? India is a sovereign, socialist, secular, democratic republic. So the next one is the citizenship. The word citizen is derived from the Latin term civis, which means resident of a city state. So here the citizenship contains the article 5 to 11 under part 2. And we are having Citizenship Act of 1955. It provides acquisition, and loss of citizenship. The meaning for the acquisition is how we have to acquire the citizenship and how will we lose the citizenship. So this had been amended so far 8 times. So what is the from which word we got the citizen? From the Latin term civis, which means resident of a city state. From which article contains deals with citizenship? Article 5 to 11. How we will get the citizenship act? By acquisition as well as by losing. We lose the citizenship. For how many times it has been amended? It has been amended so far 8 times. So how we have to acquire the citizenship? According to the Citizenship Act 1955, the citizenship could be acquired through any of the following methods. One is by birth, by descent, by registration, by naturalization, by incorporation of territory. Once again, I repeat, by birth, by descent, by registration, by naturalization, by incorporation of territory. I will explain it in detail. By birth, all persons born in India on or after January 26, 1950 are treated as citizens by birth. The second one, by descent. That is, a person born outside India on or after January 26, 1950 shall be a citizen of India by descent, but which means by the forefathers like that. If his father is a citizen of India at the time of his birth. The third one is by registration. By applying the appropriate evidences, we can acquire the citizenship. Fourth one, by naturalization. A foreigner also can acquire the Indian citizenship to the government of India. And final one, fifth one is by incorporation of territory. Maybe the government of India can specify a certain territory being added to the territory of India. So that persons of that territory also shall be the citizens of India. So in this way, in this method, we can acquire the citizenship. So what are the ways? One, by birth. Second one, by descent. Third one, by registration. Fourth one, by naturalization. Fifth one, by incorporation of territory. Next. So we learned about how we have acquired the citizenship. Then this next one is how we lose the citizenship. So here also we are having 3 ways. One is renunciation, termination, deprivation. The meaning for the renunciation is voluntarily a citizen can announce that I won't be a citizen of particular country. So voluntarily renounced by a citizen itself. The second one is termination. If a person acquires a citizenship of some other country, more than one country, if he's having in some other country also, he's having the citizenship, so that will be terminated. And third one is the deprivation. If the citizenship was acquired by any fraud or false representation, we will lose the citizenship. So what are the 3 ways of losing citizenship? Renunciation, termination, and final one, third one is the deprivation. So the Citizenship Act, we are having 2 ways. One is by getting the citizenship and second one by losing the citizenship. The next one is the fundamental rights. Very important rights you are having in our country. The fundamental rights are enshrined in part 3 of the constitution from deals with the article 12 to 35. Originally, the constitution provided for 7 fundamental rights, but at present, there are only 6 fundamental rights. The first one is right to equality. The right to equality deals with the article 14 to 18. The second one, right to freedom. It deals with article 19 to 22. And third one, right against exploitation deals with article 23 to 24. And fourth one, right to religion deals with article 25 to 28. And fifth one, cultural and educational rights. It deals with article 29 to 30. And final one, that is a right to constitutional remedies. It deals with article 32. So the first one is right to equality. So it deals with article 14 to 18, which means all citizens are equal before the law. There should not be any discrimination against any citizen on grounds of religion, language, caste, etc. And the second one is right to freedom. We are having the freedom to live anywhere, to speak, write, and express our views freely. And we can we also have the freedom to live anywhere without harming anybody, without disturbing anybody. So that right also we are having. The third one is the most important right against exploitation. So wherever the exploitation is there, we have the right to raise voice against that exploitation. So we can take it in one example. No child below the age of 14 can be employed to do any work, to force people to work more, to underpay them, to ill-treat and degrade workers are punishable in the court of law. And the fourth one, right to religion. So India is a secular state, one day already we mentioned. So anyone can follow any religion as they wish. So it deals with Article 25 to 28. And fifth one, cultural and educational rights. All citizens in India have the right to establish and maintain educational institutions of their choice. They have the right to conserve the language, the script, as well as the culture. And final one, right to constitutional remedies, which means what are the rights we are having, that is right to equality, freedom, right against exploitation, right to religion, cultural and educational rights. Any rights, if we are denied, we can appeal to the High Court as well as the Supreme Court, and the High Court and Supreme Court will preserve and protect the fundamental rights of the citizen. So this Article 32 is a very important article, and it is also called as the heart and soul of the Constitution. So which article is called as the heart and soul of the Constitution? Article 32. And what is that article deals with? What right is given? Right to constitutional remedies, as well as the Supreme Court is also called as the guardian of the Constitution. So which court is called as a guardian of the Constitution? Supreme Court. So at the starting we have learned, no, there are, we are having seven fundamental rights, but at present we are having only six fundamental rights. So which right was deleted from the fundamental rights is right to property. So it deals with Article 31. So that article is left out. We are having Article 32, the next one. So it was deleted from the list of fundamental rights by the 44th Amendment Act 1978. So it is made as a legal right under Article 308 in Part 12 of the Constitution. So which article, which right was made as a legal right? Right to property. And which article deals with? Article 31. When it was deleted from the list of fundamental rights in 1978, that is by the 44th Amendment Act. So we all learned about what are the fundamental rights of a citizen. So next one is the directive principles of the state policy. So we are having fundamental rights. Why we should have the directive principles? Yes, our constitution makers realized the need for improving the condition of the poor people, illiterate, socially and educationally backward masses. So to enhance them only, this directive principles of state policy was implemented. So the directive principles of state policy are enumerated in Part 4 of the Constitution, and here the articles deals from 36 to 51. So the directive principles deals with the articles 36 to 51. So the government is duly bound to apply all these principles while making the laws for the people. So it will be favorable to the poor people, illiterate people, socially, economically, educationally backward people. To all it should be favorable. And it is also classified into three broad categories. One is socialistic, Gandhian, liberal, intellectual. And Dr. B.R. Ambedkar described these principles as novel features of the Indian Constitution. So which is considered as a novel features of the Indian Constitution? Directive principles of state policy. And who described like that? Dr. B.R. Ambedkar. So we have learned about what are the fundamental rights and what are the what is mean by directive principles. So economically, socially, backward people to uplift them for. So what is the differences between fundamental rights and directive principles? It was derived from the I'm going to explain about the fundamental rights first. It was derived from the Constitution of USA. So the very first introduction I have given, the concept of Constitution was originated in United States of America. Here the directive principles, it was drawn on the model of the Constitution of Ireland. So it was derived from the Constitution of United States of America, and here model of the Constitution of Ireland. These are enforceable by a court of law. What are they? Fundamental. So we can appeal. If any fundamental rights are denied, we can appeal to the High Court as well as to the Supreme Court. But here for the directive principles, these are not enforceable in any court. And third one, these rights, that is fundamental rights, strengthen the political democracy in the country. And the directive principles ensures socially and economic democracy. And fundamental rights, these are the natural rights, and directive principles, these lead to protect the human rights. What are the rights? All the rights were protected by the directive principles. So these are the differences between fundamental rights and the directive principles. So it was derived from the Constitution of USA. It is a model of the Constitution of Ireland. These are enforceable. Which are enforceable by a court of law? Only the fundamental rights, and these are not enforceable in any court. And these fundamental rights strengthen political democracy, and the directive principles strengthen the social and economic democracy. And these fundamental rights are natural rights, and the directive principles protect the human rights. So we have learned about what are the fundamental rights as well as what are the directive principles. The next one, what is the differences between the directive principles as well as the fundamental one? The next one is the fundamental duties. So we are all having rights as well as duties. What are the duties we have to do for our country? Article 52A declares it to be the duty of every citizen of India. The first one, respect the national flag and the national anthem. So definitely we have to respect. So for that, many leaders, many common people also lost their life. So we have to respect the national flag as well as the national symbols, national anthem. Follow the noble ideals which inspired the national struggle for freedom. So many of the freedom fighters were fought for independence. We can take any one freedom fighter as the ideas as a noble ideas that we can follow in our life also. Protect the sovereignty, unity and integrity of India. So definitely we should be united. So only our country is called as a unity in diversity. To defend the country, we have to render national services for our country also. And we have to preserve the rich heritage of our composite culture. Protect, improve the natural environment, including we have to protect our forests, lakes, rivers, wildlife, and definitely we have to show compassion for living creatures, and we should not destroy the public properties. So we have to safeguard our public property, and to provide opportunities for education to his or her child or ward between the age of 6 and 14 years. That is compulsory education under the age of 6 to 14 years, SSA, like that, where the central government has introduced, so that we can follow. So these are our fundamental duties of our country. The final one is the official language. Part 17 of the Constitution deals with the official language in Article 343 to 351. The first language committee was appointed in 1955. It submitted its report in 1956, and Parliament enacted the Official Language Act in 1963. At present, 22 languages are recognized. In 2004, the Government of India decided to create a new category of languages called as classical language. So in which year it was declared as a classical language? 2004. Or we can ask, in 2004 the government of India decided to create new category of language. What is that? That is called as classical language. So what are the languages? Tamil in 2004, Sanskrit in 2005, Telugu in 2008, Kannada in 2008, Malayalam in 2013, and Odia in 2014. So these are the languages as considered as classical languages. So this official language deals with the article 343 to 351. So when the first language committee was appointed in 1955, when it submitted its report in 1956, and when the parliament enacted the official language in 1963. At present, how many languages are recognized? 22 languages are recognized. In 2004, the government of India created one new category of language. What it is called as classical languages. And what are the classical languages? Tamil, Sanskrit, Telugu, Kannada, Malayalam, and Odia. So what is mean by constitution? What is the need of a constitution? How we have to make the constitution? What are the salient features, important features of the constitution? And then we have learned about what is mean by preamble, citizenship, how we have to acquire the citizenship, how we will lose the citizenship, what are the fundamental rights, and which right is very important, that is heart and soul. Heart and soul of the constitution, as well as what is mean by directive principles, differences between fundamental rights and directive principles. And finally, we have learned about the official language. A small recap. The Constitution of India was framed by a constituent assembly set up under the Cabinet Mission Plan in 1946. We have learned in the earlier class. The preamble of our constitution states that India is a sovereign, socialist, secular, democratic republic. They may change and give also. For example, the one more question may come as socialist, democratic, secular, like that. We have to arrange it in a correct order. That is, India is a sovereign, socialist, secular, democratic republic. So from which word we have taken that citizen? From the Latin term civis, which means what? Resident of a city state. And which article is called as a heart and soul of the whole constitution? Article 32. And what is that right? Right to constitutional remedies. This was recognized by Dr. B.R. Ambedkar. The fundamental duties in the Indian constitution was inspired by the constitution of former USSR. In 2004, the government of India decided to create a new category of language, and that language is called as a classical language. And what are that classical languages? Tamil, Sanskrit, Telugu, Kannada, Malayalam, and Odia. Okay, we can make a small homework. We can make one activity. So we have learned about what are the fundamental rights, duties, like that. No. You can make some rules and regulations, what we have to follow in our classroom. That's your activity, today's activity. Okay. So what are the rules and regulations, or what are the rules we have to follow in your classroom? So that's your activity, today's activity. Thank you.
Namaste dear students, we will send that video link for your ID, WhatsApp ID. You can revise and also download that book. You can revise as well as. Thank you dear students, you can leave from meeting. Students, you can leave. Only mentor can stay back, others can go back. Yes, students, you can leave. Thank you.